IVM.
Welcome to All Things Policy, a daily podcast by the Takshashila Institution. We are a bunch of policy nerds based in Bengaluru, and we like bringing fresh perspectives to Indian affairs and Indian perspectives to global affairs. So grab a cup of coffee, sit back, and join us for today's chat.
Hello and welcome to this episode of All Things Policy. I'm Anupam, Manur, and I have with me Narayan Ramachandran. Today we're going to be discussing about strategic petroleum reserves and India's policy towards it. If you've noticed, oil prices have fallen to about $30 per barrel, and this provides an excellent opportunity for India to fill up its strategic petroleum reserves. Strategic petroleum reserves by itself, basically it is a form of storage of crude oil and other forms of oil so that in times of emergency, you can release it and try to restore some form of balance. It's ultimately a national security tool in times of crisis. Narayan, how important is it for India, which imports a lot of its oil, to have a strategic petroleum reserve and, you know, have a broad policy objective about it?
So Anupam, yeah, as you rightly said, India is a major importer of oil, number one. Number two, a significant proportion of its oil is imported. Numbers are between 80 and 90% of its oil is imported. So India is heavily dependent on the import of oil to effectively run pretty much everything. Oil is the source of energy in its myriad forms in the economy. And until sometime much, much later, when we have alternative sources of energy that play a major role, we will need to import oil for quite some time. And so when you import something like oil, the question naturally arises, what if there are shocks, shocks of supply or shocks of price? Often related, but if there are shocks of supply and price, what happen if India is caught short at a moment like that? So both for its own economic security, simply running the trains every day, keeping the electricity on every day, keeping, you know, furnaces burning every day and so on, you need oil. And this way and that, India has oil above ground that we claim has several days of storage. Yeah. We'll get into the numbers in a second, but I think the time has come for a oil-dependent country like India to declare a much more aggressive objective on its strategic petroleum reserve and save a little bit more than it is saving in the form of its SPR. We'll get into what form in just a second.
Yeah. So the kind of shocks that you spoke about, there was an attack on Saudi Arabia's Aramco facility. There was, for example, there's US put sanctions on Iran. These are the typical kind of supply shocks that could happen. Always geopolitical risk is there, and India is vulnerable to any geopolitical risk that could threaten the supply of oil. And therefore, it kind of makes sense to have this strategic petroleum reserves.
Anupam, I may just add, since we're living in the age of the novel coronavirus, that this particular virus is playing out in the way that we all know, so I won't repeat it. But you could imagine a case where, you know, major shipping lines were shut down, not just for a few days at a time, but weeks at a time. For instance, LNG in China is now shut down in many, many ports around that country. So just a little tweak to what we know of the novel coronavirus. And you could imagine a situation where both for our basic economic security and our national security. Now, on the national security side, just imagine blockades either to the east or west of us.
Yeah.
And if you have a naval blockade, for whatever reason, that could be another reason why we would want to guarantee ourselves. Bringing oil through any land route from outside India, metaphorically speaking, has been a pipe dream. And the pipes haven't been delivered.
Yeah. So there are various ways in which you can hold SPR. So you can hold it, for example, underground through, you know, caverns. And so salt caverns dug deep into the earth is one of the best places to store petroleum so that it doesn't evaporate. The other one is you can keep it in refineries itself, what India, by the way, does. You could also have a combination of, you know, government owning stocks, private players owning stocks. You could have mandated industry stocks. You could create a separate agency and tell it to hold stocks on the behalf of the government and so on. So there are various permutations and combinations of how the SPR can work. Sometimes you could even hold stocks abroad. So you could ask another country to hold stocks on your behalf. And I think I know the answer for this, but what should India's strategy be? I mean, what kind of these permutations would work, or is it all of the above in some various forms?
Yeah, Anupam, you and I have discussed this in many, many, many times, that for many of India's both strategic and economic issues and concerns, the answer usually has to be all of the above.
Yeah.
The reason, at least at a high conceptually, why it has to be all of the above is that think of strategic petroleum reserves as a physical insurance policy
right.
on our oil demand each day, each week, each month, right? Because it's a physical insurance policy, and let me give you a metaphor. Suppose you think that you will run out of rice or wheat at home. And as a consequence, you are going to keep storage of rice or wheat at your house for 90 days.
Right.
That, by the way, is the IEA required, Energy Agency required mandate for all countries is 90 days. So think of it. I'm storing rice and wheat for 90 days in my house. And I live in a typical two-bedroom urban, you know, 1,500 square foot home, which is short of space. So the first thing is there is a cost to space. The second thing is there is demurrage. That is actually, you know, maybe urban rats running around yeah. and or other things. And there's a natural life cycle too. Now, crude is not blessed necessarily with a decline in its quality over time. But there is cost to storage. And cost to actually building that storage
yeah.
In the same way that you might think of a cost to build a pantry in the house. So there is physical insurance cost to all of this. And given that India has so many different uses for its money, it needs to use money for the SPR in a wise manner. And wisdom is easy to demonstrate when you're doing it in all of the above. And just for clarity, let me say what all of the above is. So first, India should store both above ground and below ground.
Yeah.
That's first idea of diversification. The second idea is it should store both crude and refined product, right? The idea that you do unrefined as well as refined. The third idea is that it should store geographically diversified so that if there's a blockade on the East Coast, then you can supply from the West Coast and vice versa. Also, the cost of movement is reduced if it is in multiple locations. So it needs to be geographically diversified. A further instance of geographic diversification is that you could even hold it outside the country. So we could, on a bilateral basis, ask Abu Dhabi to hold it for us, or in a very different, Abu Dhabi is, of course, crude oil, a resource-rich country, but you could have a storage-rich country like Japan potentially,
yeah.
Which has strategic considerations with India, might be willing to store some oil for us, which again geographically diversifies our oil. So all of these ways are different ways by which I think we should diversify and do all of the above. Anupam, you should talk a little bit about the idea of how the private sector can hold oil for an emergency. But there, the contract is very important.
Yeah, I think the fourth form of diversification that I want to talk about is this government owning stocks versus the private sector owning stocks. So you could have some part of the SPR which is owned fully by the government such that it has control of when it can release and so on. But the private sector holding stocks, I think, can provide a very interesting case study. So while it obviously, as you mentioned, it has a large, you know, building an SPR is not cheap, filling it up is not cheap, and then maintaining it is not cheap. So government might not have the resources to do all of it on its own. And it could get into, hypothetically speaking, a form of partnership with the private sector. So you could have a consortium, for example. You could have a infrastructure company that will dig deep into the earth and build this kind of salt cavern ready for storage. You could have a financing company that will actually finance the purchase of oil and for filling it up. And of course, an oil company which will look after the purchase and sale of oil. So how it would work for a private company or this consortium is that essentially they would work on price arbitrage. So they would essentially fill it up There are various mechanisms through which you can mention how many days that, how many years that you can contract for. So first 3 years, you could, for example, spend on just digging the entire cavern and then filling it up. And then next 7 years, you can use it for price arbitrage. So when the prices are low, you buy oil, fill it up, and then you can sell when the price goes up, and which it invariably does. But I think there are certain things that you need to be very specific about. So for example, the government needs to mention in no uncertain terms in a contract saying that there are some form of mandatory minimums. So you could, for example, if the cavern holds X number of million ton barrels, then you could specify that a range of, let's say, 25% to 30% should not be used at all. It is purely meant for emergency purposes, and the other 50% can be used for commercial purposes. So I think that kind of arrangement would be both in the favor of the private companies.
So Anupam, I could illustrate to stretch my metaphor of storing rice and wheat.
Yeah.
Think of my neighbor who has two pantries.
Yeah.
And I ask him or her to say, okay, now I need 10 kilos of wheat for the next 90 days. And why don't you store those 10 kilos for me? I will pay you for storing those 10 kilos. But in an emergency, you should be able to give me no less than 3 kilos if I ask for it.
Yeah.
The other 7 kilos in a non-emergency, you can do a price arbitrage on. So if you think about this in a pantry and regular commodity terms, it becomes a lot easier. But the strange thing is we are not applying our mind to this as systematically as we should. In fact, Anupam and our research team here at Takshashila discovered that the last parliamentary question on this topic was raised more than 12 years ago.
Yeah.
Clearly not a high priority item for anybody, and when it should be so, because oil is such an important commodity for our economy. So what we've done at Takshashila is we've brought out a research report that speaks about all of this. And I'm going to get Anupam to take you through the first two or three recommendations, and then I'll add the last two.
So the first bit, I think, is to have a very formal process of how do you mobilize the petroleum reserves during a time of emergency. I think just having very clear rules on which authority gets to call it an emergency, then defining the emergency very well, because you don't want SPR to be used for fiscal purposes. You know, if you're short of money, the government can't tap into the SPR, sell oil and make money, right? So no abuse of the strategic petroleum reserves. And therefore, that means you need to, A, define the emergency very well. You need to define which authority gets to call it an emergency. And then how will it actually mobilize the underground reserves? So that's not a very easy process, because you have to, of course, extract the crude oil from the underground, let's say, caverns. Then you need to refine it and then sell it to different bidders at various price points. So I think this entire process needs to be thought through very carefully and put it basically in a very nice
protocol.
SOP. That's the way. And I think that you don't need to reinvent the wheel on many of these things. The United States, for example, has very clear protocols of what constitutes an emergency. I mean, we can, of course, tailor it to our own situation, but at least all the things that requires to be done in order to draw down on the SPR is already out there. There are several countries of which are members of the IEA has very well-defined set of protocols. So I think we can just adopt some of those things and then tailor it to our own very specific situation. So that's the one important kind of aspect. The second one, I think we already kind of spoke about, which was defining these mandatory minimums for the private sector company, and then also getting into contracts with them saying that not only will they not touch that that range of, let's say, 30% or 40% of the reserves that they hold, but also that the government will have the first right of refusal during a time of emergency. So irrespective of what other conditions are, if an emergency is called out, then the government gets the first right of refusal on the sale of SPR. I think that is the second important one. Third, I think need to have a particular price point at which you will say that, when the price falls below this, we will actually start filling up the
SPR. Or at least considering.
Yeah. At least consider it, yeah. So I think now, for example, when the price has fallen down to 30, if you had, let's say that every time it falls below 45, we will bring up this question of whether we should use this as an opportunity to fill up the SPR, would have proved useful, because now I don't think we're looking at, using this as an opportunity to fill up the SPR. So that is
simply
probably,
because it's out of sight, out of mind, right?
Yeah.
And you can just imagine that even if it costs $5, $6, $7 a barrel to mobilize such oil. If you buy it at $30, $35 on average, your blended released price, let's say, is $42. I mean, we would give an arm and a leg to have $42 price of oil per barrel at times in which we have been, even in the recent past, where it has been $60, $70, $80. And not to mention at times like in 2010 when it was $140 a barrel, right? And that becomes a severe economic constraint when it reaches those ridiculous prices. So I think the third one, which is to have guideline prices at which you seriously consider filling up your SPR, I think is an important one. The fourth point, and I'll let Anupam speak about the last one, but the fourth point is think of SPR again as like foreign exchange reserves. As you know, many democracies, including India, publish foreign exchange reserves on a daily basis. If foreign exchange reserves are no great national secret, there is no real reason why SPR and the number of days of oil we have should be a secret. For somewhat thoughtless reasons, we have this notion that this represents some big secret that we need to keep well hidden, so much so that even former petroleum secretaries we spoke to had no idea what was being done where. At that kind of, you know, lack of spending time kind of secret is of little use to us. Much better for us to actually throw a lot of sunshine on it and have both scholars and think tanks opine on where we are, what could we be doing, what are the alternatives, what are the types of civil contracts and so on. So
inviting scrutiny will not hamper national security in any way. It would probably just increase it, right? Because you need to ask these questions of, just to give you an idea, India has at various points of time, I mean, ISPRL at least, held press conferences and said that we have 87 days worth of SPR. But that is actually far from the truth. It is, in fact, 87 days is the planned capacity, not even actual capacity that we have, but the planned capacity over the next 10 years or so.
But I think maybe better to say to be planned.
To be planned capacity, yeah. Because in reality, what we know is this, that refineries in India, and they're spread across, you know, India, and they're, some of them are, of course, I mean, most of them are publicly owned. They hold about 65 days of oil reserves, according to the statement, which is the bulk of your reserves. We don't know, for example, we don't know whether this is held in crude, whether this is held in as refined product. Just first level of opaqueness that exists. And then, of course, we do not know what is the mobilization process even from these companies. So yes, they are of course publicly owned, but how will they give up the oil? To who will they give up the oil to? How can it be used, etc.? We don't have clarity on that aspect. But the more interesting bit is with the underground caverns. Now, phase one is actually built, as we know. That has got, you know, two sites, Mangalore and Visakhapatnam. We know that these sites are built, for example, but we don't know how much of it has been, you know, actually filled up. So that has 10 days capacity. Estimates, and, you know, this is being very vague, but estimates suggest that only about 5 or 6 days of capacity is actually there in oil. The second phase is, no work has begun. We've gotten into talks with Aramco, for example, getting into these public-private partnerships, but there's been no movement on it. So this 87 days is actually, when you bring it down, is more like, I don't know, 70 days at best, but that includes 65 days of holdings by the refineries. So transparency, having transparency in this entire process, I think is extremely important.
Anupam, I think that, you know, for the next 25 years or so, India will be in this transition from old-fashioned energy, from crude, to much more renewable energy forms that we will get into. For instance, the use of solar for electricity generation and so on. And India is doing a commendable job in at least that one specific transformation. But believing that the role of crude will diminish dramatically in the next 20 years or so is kidding ourselves.
Yeah.
And therefore, we might as well prepare for it in a much better way than we are currently prepared. And the experience of other countries, while it can, well, we can borrow SOPs and other things, is not germane to where we are, because India is, if not the most dependent, among the most dependent countries on imported oil of all.
Yeah.
So I would say perhaps Japan and India are the two, maybe South Korea to some extent, are the three most import-dependent countries. And somehow, we need to ensure that we protect ourselves from severe supply disruptions.
Right. This is then gets you to the next stage where Japan is already, you know, is far ahead, as you spoke about, in terms of thinking about energy security and especially petroleum reserves. So there could be a possibility of getting into bilateral or some form of multilateral arrangements for this particular resource. So, for example, there are multiple ways in which, I mean, you can also look at the SPR as a geopolitical tool. Part of this would be, let's say, allowing Aramco to not just use it for price arbitrage within India, but also to other countries. So we could, for example, hold oil reserves for other countries as well. That's one possible area that we could explore, and that would give further incentives for the private players to act up. But in other sense, we could, for example, get into an agreement with South Korea and Japan in terms of exchanging. So there could be, for example, an instance where a geopolitical risk affects one but not all three countries. And in that sense, in that kind of scenario, you could have these arrangements which could work out quite well.
Absolutely. I think, you know, our whole point in one bringing this topic to discussion and through the policy discussion document that's now out on the website is one to draw a lot of attention to what is a very, very critical energy source for us. And two, for us to actually take some thoughtful decisions about how we might go about correcting the situation to some degree. So I would encourage all of you, at least those of you who are interested to know a little bit more about this, to look online and get the discussion document. There's a lot of detail in there. And as always, we would love to hear any comments or questions you have on a somewhat complicated topic, but one that is very, very important as India's growth continues in the decades ahead.
All right. Thank you so much, Narayan, for joining us. The third author, by the way, is Rohan Seth. And thanks for listening to this particular episode. Do join in again tomorrow for another episode of All Things Policy.
If you liked our show, don't forget to check out other interesting podcasts on the IVM network. You can tune into them on the IVM Podcast app, ivmpodcast.com, or wherever you listen to your podcasts. You can also follow IVM on social media. The handle is @IVMPodcasts on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. And hey, if you'd like to dive into Takshashila's research on technology, strategy, and economic affairs, check us out at our Twitter handle @TakshashilaInst or our website takshashila.org.in.
I hope you enjoyed that show. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, HDFC Life and Paytm Money. Also, just a very quick note, I would really appreciate it if you guys could fill out a really short survey on our website. It's on ivmpodcast.com/survey. It's just a brand recognition survey for us to kind of work with the advertisers and give them some data. So it's a very short, less than 1 minute survey. Really appreciate your help in filling it out. And let me tell you a couple of things that you should check out this week. On IVM Likes, Alika, Antariksh and Sumit talk about some weird and bizarre shows and movies that they've seen. On Geek Fruit, Tejas and Dinkar just saw Pixar's new movie Onward. Tune in to find out what they thought of it. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by Rohit Taparia, Vice President of Isprava and Lohono Stays. They talk about the journey of an entrepreneur in the luxury home segment. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam talks with Kalpen Parekh, President at DSP Mutual Fund, about various frameworks of mutual funds. On Absolutely Right, Aditi is joined by Rachel Lopez. They dive into her personality by analyzing her handwriting. Thanks and keep listening.
Janice, what do you think couples did before TV was invented?
I don't know, go for walks on the beach, long drives, fancy dinners, have more sex maybe?
But what did we do when we decided to move in together? We debated between the Chromecast and the Fire Stick.
We gave up on sleeping early so we could stay up watching true crime shows.
We got ourselves 3 cat babies.
And basically became the cutest couch potatoes around.
Okay then.
In case you guys still haven't got it, we are a TV crazy, Netflix loving, binge watching Mr. and Mrs.
I'm Anirudh Guha.
I'm Janice Iquera.
And if like us, you snort TV for breakfast, lunch and dinner, this is the podcast for you.
Tune in every Thursday on the IVM Podcast app or wherever it is that you get your podcast from. This is
Mr.
and Mrs.
Binge Watch.